If you would like to get your song reviewed, dear listener, there's the Filthy Capitalist option. It's where he says, 125 gets you straight to the head of the line. You don't have to be a part of the alliance. You don't have to be part of the group.
Wait a minute.
And the biggest thing is you don't have to wait. You hop, skip, and jump right in front of everybody. 125 gets you there. You do that 3 times, and you get mashed down to the $75 rate for perpetuity.
Yes!
Also, there is a band review option. So if you've got a band and you're trying to get your band some exposure, hit me up at insoria@gmail.com, and I'll show you the details about how to pull
you
that off.
You can also jump on Patreon, and there is a option on the tiers to be able to get your band reviewed. Yep. Obviously, we can't lie to you, so we
can't guarantee a positive review.
Get what you get.
It's just rubbish.
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 That's British for garbage.
My favorite is the community option. $1 at the gate gets you into Patreon. You get to join an alliance. The alliance joins their points together, and that helps determine what songs that we do.
The alliances hang out on Discord.
Message me on Patreon to get the link.
And they do all kinds of other cool things. They do Minecraft. Dungeons and Dragons.
Yeah. It's really a community within the community. Anybody can go on the village, facebook.com/VinandSori. There's 160,000+ people on the channel. What's cool about the Discord is that it offers a real opportunity for community connection, friendship, that type of thing.
But, and it's on Discord, so if you're not a Facebook person, it's for you.
You start off at $1.
Right.
Plus you get exclusives. Sori and I are working on a song. So the first 15 seconds of that was on Patreon. Also, at $15 tier and above, when we actually debut the video, they're going to be there live with us. There you are, dear listener.
Buy our merch.
Buy our merch indeed. A child shall lead them.
To buy our merch. All right. Up next is... Whoops. I was going to say Tutti Frutti is next. It's not, though. up next is The Platters, The Great Pretender. This is considered the first R&B number one hit on main pop charts.
Oh, R&B this time, okay.
Mm-hmm. And 12th top for 1956. The group originally recorded in more gospel style, but changed their style to get higher radio airplay and convinced their record label, Mercury Records, to remove the Race record label from their album covers and marketing. This song went to number one in 1956, and the footage you will see is from the movie Rock Around the Clock, a promotional film for the song of the same name. It was written and produced by their manager, Buck Ram. The larger political environment at this time is that we were at the Montgomery bus boycott era. Keep in mind, this is an African-American group that wanted their songs to be heard by a white audience.
Okay, so it's a black group who wants to be heard by a white audience?
The Platters... The Great Pretender.
The Platters, The Great Pretender. Let's do it.
Oh, yes, I'm the Great Pretender. Can tell.
Oh.
Oh, yes, I'm the Great Pretender. Adrift in a world of my own. I play the games, but to my real shame, you've left me to dream all alone. Conceal. Oh, yes, I'm the Great Pretender. Just laughing and gay like a clown. I seem to be what I'm not. You see, I'm wearing my heart like a crown. You're still around. Too real is this feeling of make believe. Too real when I feel great pretender. Just laughing and gay like the clown. I seem to be what I'm not. You see, I'm wearing my heart like a crown, pretending that you're still around.
I'm a great pretender, just laughing gay like a clown. I seem to be, this seems to be like a breakup song. Like an old,
yeah, it does.
Old school breakup song. And he's like trying to stunt. 1955. So he's trying to stunt like everything is okay, but
yeah,
it's a breakup.
Yeah. Okay, so one thing that I've noticed, particularly with black artists, is that their songs are a lot of times sad, from what I've heard. And I don't necessarily... Vin is the big lyric guy, and I, you know, like, try to push myself to pay attention to lyrics, especially if we're doing a review. But generally speaking, I'm not a lyric person. I just like to play the song for how the song makes me feel. And so, like, the other night, like, we're driving around, and Vin's got the music going. I'm just driving. And I'm loving one of these rap songs. Like, it's making me feel some sort of way, a way I like to feel. And then all of a sudden, Vin's composure keeps dropping. I'm like, the fuck? Why is he getting like that? And then I realized the song was such some horrible, horrible people dying or all kinds of stuff. Like, all this tragedy was happening in the song. And I was like, oh my gosh. So you were relating to the song, you know, probably, you know, by stuff that you had seen and felt and experienced. And I was just experiencing the song to how rap culture was introduced to me. You know, like, it was like, here you go. This is about movement and sex. And that's all I thought it was. I didn't realize there was so many, like, sad topics behind it. And so it was weird because, like, this song is another, in my opinion, great example of that. Like, to me, without looking at the lyrics, this was like, I would like to be cooking in the kitchen. I enjoy cooking if I have nothing to do and I'm not being rushed and I don't have a bunch of people talking to me. I don't enjoy being talked to when I'm cooking, unless it's you. You're literally the only exception. When you used to sit and chat with me while I was cooking, I loved every bit of that. But, yeah, so this to me was like cooking in the kitchen, you know, barefoot. I love being barefoot, blah, 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 cleaning, cooking in there. And the windows are open, so the air is coming through. And then you come into the kitchen and we start dancing, slow dancing. And then I realized it was a breakup song.
But I feel like that's a scene in like thousands of homes back in the 50s. Like the guy, the ladies playing that on the record player. I'm the great woo woo, and then the guy's coming in from work with his little, you know, horn rimmed glasses and shit, with his little you know, olive green car. He slams the door. He's got his little briefcase.
Yeah.
And he opens the door, and then he's assaulted by the smells of his beautiful wife, and the kids are down for a nap. And then he strolls into the living room with all the little, you know, the flowers and shit, you know, whatever. And then he goes in there and he does a little soiree with his little nice little perky 1950s wife, man. That's like the life. That's Americana. That's how a lot of that shit went down. Like,
yeah, I like that. I like that scene.
Yeah, I don't think a lot of people are like really looking like to really exegete the lyrics like we do. I just think it was like a woo woo.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? But Lisa said something crazy. Record companies used to
put was insane.
White groups on the record companies of black groups to sell records to white people.
That makes sense though, given the time. That they would do that.
Yeah, and then
here's
BC. The milkman leaves out the back door. Damn you, BC!
BC, wait a minute. Amy, did you figure out, is BC male or female? What's going on
BC's,
here?
BC's a dude. He called me one time on Middle America.
Had to be, after that comment.
Yeah, yeah. Milkman leaves out the back door. But, like, again, like, the big thing about, like, this music is, like, I understand there is shit going down, obviously. But it just seems like a very, it just seemed like a very simple life, man.
I know.
You know what I'm saying? Like,
yeah.
You know, but at the same, it's weird because, like, there's a part of me that's like, oh, man, what a life those people. But then there's another part of me that's like, man, I love living the life that we have now. Like, we could never have done this back in that time. You know what I'm saying? Like, this, it's so much better now for people like us. But at the same time, it's like, I don't know, man. It seemed like those people had it made. And I don't know, like, what is it about modernity in America that's like changed, you know, the simplicity of life, you know? I don't know. But at the same time,
I mean, it's decisions that you make. You know, my life previous to this one was extremely simple. There was a lot of garden time, barefoot outdoor time. The house was not really, the less things that you have, the easier it is to keep everything clean. You know, you have more clothes than I have.
Yeah.
But in my previous relationship, it was just basically a typical guy with a couple of t-shirts, a couple pairs of pants. You know, that makes it very easy. You'd be trying on stuff, changing shirts throughout the day, piles of laundry.
It's true.
So, I mean, but at the same time,
you're the black man now. You're the black man.
I like your style. We have a lot of fun together. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, it's give and take. It's not all one.
At the same time, though, like, this also shows how it doesn't matter what time period you're in, something's always going to be universal. Mm-hmm. So, losing your girl after a breakup and trying to pretend like you're all happy. You notice he says, like, I'm just laughing and gay like a clown. Gay obviously means happy in this context. Mm-hmm. It's funny because we were just doing the Little Richie song with the Tutti Frutti.
Mm-hmm.
And now here he is saying he's happy and gay as a clown. I remember the first time that I discovered that gay was, because I didn't know. I went to a Christian academy, so my teacher, she would use terms like gay and things like that in the proper
way.
Like, oh, you guys had a gay time at the thing. And yeah.
That's interesting. Okay.
And so then I went home and I was like, yeah, we had a gay time playing football or whatever. It's like, oh yeah, was there a gay time playing football? I was like, yeah, it was
wonderful. Oh, yeah.
Did you like bending over? I was like, well, I didn't have to bend over. It was like the other guy bent over, but it's a gay time. And then my brother was like, you idiot! And he grabbed me. He's like, you idiot! Don't you understand what that means? I'm like, yeah, it means we had fun! Gay! What the fuck? What are you talking about? He's like, no, you idiot!
I remember, like, when our kids first discovered that. And so I came downstairs, and they were like, one of them was like, we've been having a gay time, Mom. And I was like, oh, okay. And then the other one was like, yeah, it's been a gay time! Do you know what the word means? And I'm like, what are these kids? They think that...
They,
like,
truly think that they...
so unbelievable.
They've
discovered something that we didn't previously laugh about when we were in the fourth grade, except you guys are twice that age.
Now Revo's saying something really interesting because he's saying in those days you had to pretend that it was a simple life. So maybe I'm just falling for the propaganda. Maybe the life wasn't that simple at all. But you had to pretend that the life was as simple and as basic as that, and that everything was just honky-dory when in reality you weren't, which is the whole point of I'm the Great Pretender.
Well, that's interesting.
Look, he says, pretending that I'm doing too well, my need is such that I pretend too much. I'm lonely, but nobody can tell.
Mm-hmm.
Which is
interesting. Pretend that you had a simple life. Well, I mean,
yeah,
if,
like,
you stop and think about it, like, okay, if we're going to look at Leave It to Beaver, that black and white show, they did try to convey a relatively simple life. But when I stop and I think about it, I'm like, every day, her hair, her makeup, her heels, her dress, everything was all perfect. And the house was perfect. So that means she was cooking, cleaning, perfecting her beauty, and making sure that everything was good. And then that was kind of the silliness of the show, or maybe the drive of the show, was that Leave It to Beaver was always messing stuff up.
Yeah.
And so maybe that was sort of like, yeah, okay, you have this life, but you also have kids. So maybe you're right, Revo. Well, maybe they were supposed to...
The kid was the chaos element.
He was
shit.
But it wasn't like having six of him. There was only one of him, and his brother was older, like Dorian's age, so...
I could buy that.
You know, so he was the one that was always screaming. So, but there was only two kids, so it could only get so screwed up. But yeah, I mean, maybe you're right. Maybe they did have to project a certain simplicity back then that we...
That's probably why this song blew up, because this must have been a huge song, right? Was this song a big song? This must have been a big song. He was probably tapping into how everybody felt. You know what I'm saying? Maybe people really, really... And it must have been that way because 5 years later, the 60s hit and the 60s blew everything up. You had the sexual revolution. You had all these different revolutions popping off in the 60s. You had feminist movement jumped off. So, yeah, maybe that was the whole point. Okay, so Revo's saying that this was a huge song. So maybe that was the issue. Was maybe like this song was like...
Yeah.
I mean, it was 5 years before America and pretty much the Western world really blew up after that. Maybe people were acting like they were good when they really weren't. And this was kind of like the anthem for people, for the entire generation of people. Holy shit. All right. Well.
But I really enjoyed this one. I like the, you know, and I'm watching him. He doesn't look like he's very old. And I'm like, okay, so when Dorian is our oldest. He's 16. Is he 17?
He's going to be 17 in October.
Okay, he's going to be 17. Okay. Whew, scared me for a second there. So anyway, he, like, when he gets the keyboard out and he starts playing, I love that. But he's the only one of our kids that does anything musically. This guy seemed, relatively young to me, what it looked like to me. And so I was thinking, like, wow, wouldn't that be great to have one of our kids that... Because he really, like, put forth the sound. Like, he opened his mouth and he just let the sound, like... You know how there's, you know, people kind of sing with their mouth around?
Yeah.
Like, he just belted it.
Sold out.
Yeah, and I love that. And you do see that, or I've seen that a lot with black vocalists. It just seems like they just really... And it seems like that there's a lot of control over their vocal cords. Like, it doesn't look like that was difficult for him to do.
I just think with any gifted singer, they're just really good at that. I've seen white folks do that too. Like, when they're just gifted, they're just...
Yeah.
Like, Toki was like that. She could just...
She yeah.
Just take off.
Yeah.
Like, effortlessly. It was unbelievable.
Yeah.
But you're too much in your head. In my opinion.
I'm not like that. But anyway.
I don't see much difference between you and Toki as far as singing ability goes. You guys to sit by you doing worship and stuff.
Oh, like
when you weren't in your head, you were like, oh, remember
that was different,
that
yeah.
girl? That Melissa girl was trained. She's trained. And she never wanted to sing when you were singing.
Yeah. Yeah.
But anyway, give this score a song.
9.4. I like this
one. I'm going to give this a 10. Because I feel like this is probably a classic song, and I feel like this is a lyrically it's you could say it's directly about a breakup, but I also think it's probably talking about the collective distress that a lot of people were in the 50s to pretend. I think Revo, that kind of like shifted my paradigm on it, and so because of that. You know, a lot of times, like, when I say, oh, this must have been a big song, mm-hmm. most of the times people are like, yes, you idiot, this has been, like, mm-hmm. a super classic. So I feel like this is one of those songs. So
yeah,
I'm going to give this one a 10. I'm going to give this one a 10 because I really feel like sonically it was good. It stays in your head. And if I was around in the 50s, like, this would have been my jam, obviously. So there you are. This is song of the day for me so far. But we got more music coming for you, beautiful people. Stay tuned. Revo Week in full effect. We haven't even begun, dear listener. It's going to be great every single day till you get tired of us. 3 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Thin out.
Sorry out.
Gone.